Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Peter Overton. Four children have tragically been killed in a house fire in Melbourne's southwest. We go live now to Elizabeth Moss. Elizabeth, good afternoon. Neighbours desperately tried to help the family.
They did, Peter. A devastating situation which has unfolded in the early hours of this morning in Melbourne's west. We know that neighbours heard screaming, they heard sirens, they came out, they saw that the house just behind me was completely alight. They could hear the father of the house screaming for his four children who were still inside. Now, luckily, the father, the mother and their eight-year-old son managed to escape with their lives. But sadly, this morning, police confirmed the worst fears. Four children aged between 10 and a one-year-old baby girl were found dead inside. Now, at this stage, police don't know exactly what caused the blaze. Detectives from the arson squad have spent the morning here combing through the scene, sifting through the rubble, what's left of that family home of seven, as they try to piece together what's happened. The fire was so strong, firefighters couldn't even get in the door when they arrived on scene this morning.
I'm trying to keep it together. That's very sad.
The complexity involves then having four children that are trapped inside the house and in a way feeling a little bit helpless that you can't get in there because...
A very upsetting scene, not just for those emergency services who attended here, but for the wider community, the residents who witnessed this fire as well. The police cordon has just come down in the last few moments. We've already seen some residents coming and laying flowers. They saw the story on the news and were so affected they wanted to write a letter to those parents to say, stay strong. Peter?
So desperately sad. OK, Elizabeth, thank you. 54-year-old man has died after an incident at the Curra mine near Blackwater in central Queensland overnight. It's the second death at the site in less than 2 years. All work has now ceased indefinitely while the worker's death is investigated. A man has been killed in a crash south of Adelaide. The 68-year-old man died when his car slammed into a tree and caught fire on Port Road at Aldinga around 7:30 this morning. Major crash police investigators are trying to piece together the moments leading up to the smash. His death is the 90th life lost on South Australian roads this year, compared to 79 at the same time last year. The parliamentary sitting fortnight kicks off tomorrow and there is trouble in the ranks of the coalition, with two rebel senators vowing to derail government bills. Nine's political editor Chris Yuleman explains.
The Prime Minister has been vocal in his opposition to state-imposed vaccine mandates, but there's very little he can do to overturn them. That's not good enough for Pauline Hanson, who is threatening to use the two One Nation votes to block all government bills in the Senate until it overrules the states on mandates. With the numbers always tight in the upper house, that's bad enough for the coalition, but it looks like it's going to get a whole lot worse because two of its own senators are now threatening to abstain from voting.
My intention this week is to withhold my vote from the government until they deal with a couple of COVID issues around, first of all, the discrimination against people who haven't been vaccinated, number one, and number two is to provide a better compensation for people who have been injured by vaccines.
With tough votes ahead in the coming fortnight over things like the government's long-awaited and highly contentious religious freedom bill, the Assistant Treasurer is urging his colleagues to stay in the tent.
I'm very confident that in the end, they will make wise decisions about all of those issues when it comes time to vote in the Senate.
In the lower house battles this week, expect the government to push Labor to release its target for 2030 emissions cuts, while the opposition will continue its assault on the character of the Prime Minister and increasing hip pocket pain at the petrol pump.
Petrol prices have gone up on average over the last year, something like $900 for an average family with an average car, at the same time as real wages have gone backwards $700 over the last year.
The government says some things are beyond its control.
Global factors like exchange rates, like the cost of crude oil.
And the cost the coalition wants to highlight is the chance of tax hikes.
The Labor Party are always chasing higher spending, and in order to chase higher spending, we see the inevitable consequence, which is higher taxes.
It will be the usual cranky end of the year, not helped by the continuing COVID restrictions in Parliament House and fuelled by the knowledge that the stakes are rising with an election due in the first half of next year.
Chris, thank you. Australia has welcomed back tourists from Singapore for the first time in almost 2 years. Justine Conway reports.
Well, the Singapore Airlines flight carrying 170 passengers touched down here in Melbourne this morning. The first international tourist from Asia to land in Melbourne in 22 months.
I was quite nervous, actually, yes. But once you settled in, got your seatbelt on, it was fine.
This is the launch of Green Lane Travel, the new normal, an agreement between Australia and Singapore where all passengers must hold vaccine passports and undergo PCR tests pre-departure and on arrival. If they're clear, there's no quarantine.
So to have Singapore as our first country of arrival into the nation for fully vaccinated tourists and Singaporean residents is a terrific first step for us.
Among those to touch down this morning, families who haven't seen each other in more than a year. Singapore is among the top 10 source countries for Australia. To rekindle the love, our federal government launched this $4 million tourism campaign. Before the pandemic, more than 400,000 tourists visited Melbourne each year and spent $319 million.
We have amazing culinary experiences in Melbourne and all across our whole state. Of course, we've got our magnificent major events calendar, which is such a huge draw card.
Melbourne isn't open to all countries like this just yet. So far, Singapore citizens and New Zealanders are the only foreigners allowed to fly in the Green Lane. And while it's yet to be confirmed, there are reports the next countries in line will be Japan and South Korea.
Justine, thank you. New technology is helping to support type 1 diabetes patients, but a lack of subsidy means it comes with a financial burden for most. Nine's Sophie Upcroft has more for us.
Doctors and patients are calling on the federal government to subsidise a new technology that helps type 1 diabetes sufferers better manage their condition and help prevent long-term complications associated with the disease. The continuous glucose monitoring technology is a patch that patients apply to their arms. It consistently reads their blood sugar levels and can be read on an app on their phone, testing the blood every minute and storing that data to give the patient an indication whether their blood sugar levels are heading up or down, allowing them to avoid a spike either way.
You can end up in a coma if it's too low. If it's too high, you get long-term consequences.
Heart disease, kidney disease, eye disease in the future.
The government currently subsidises this technology for people under the age of 21, women who are pregnant or trying for a baby, or if you have a concession card. But there are still 70,000 type 1 diabetes sufferers who aren't eligible, costing them an average of $22,000 a year. Specialists are now pushing for the government to help cover the cost and extend this subsidy to every patient, a move already made by several other countries.
Thank you, Sophie. Australia's biggest drone show will unfold over the skies of Melbourne as cities across the nation welcome back crowds for New Year's Eve celebrations. Adam Hegarty has more.
Well, it almost goes without saying these days, but city businesses have had a tough old time during COVID shutdowns for the past 2 years, so they're always looking at ways to entice people back into the Melbourne CBD. So New Year's Eve this year will certainly be no exception. Melbourne City Council announcing quite a spectacular drone light show ahead of traditional fireworks for New Year's celebrations this year.
I'm absolutely delighted that Melbourne will be hosting the biggest swarm drone show in the Southern Hemisphere here in Docklands on New Year's Eve.
Very similar to what was seen over Edinburgh in 2020 New Year's Eve celebrations there. 350 drones lighting up the night sky, but it will not be without your traditional COVID restrictions. 40,000 crowd will be the cap, spread across four different locations in the CBD. And yes, everyone will need to be vaccinated. And they'll try to keep the momentum going. The drone show will continue throughout January.
All right, Adam, thank you.